Simon & Schuster Audio presents Shakespeare Was a Woman and Other Heresies, How Doubting the Bard Became the Biggest Taboo in Literature, by Elizabeth Winkler. Read by Eunice Wong. I have come to think of history as a game that we play with the past. Beverly Southgate. Prologue. In England, in the summer of 1964, an unusual case came before the courts. It involved a squabble over the will of Miss Evelyn May Hopkins and the authorship of the works of William Shakespeare. Miss Hopkins had died, leaving a third of her inheritance to the Francis Bacon Society for the purpose of finding the original manuscripts of Shakespeare's plays. She referred to them as the Bacon-Shakespeare manuscripts, believing the true author of the works to have been Francis Bacon, the Elizabethan philosopher and statesman. The aim of finding the manuscripts was to prove that Bacon was, in fact, the author of the works attributed to Shakespeare. Her heirs were not pleased. Naturally, they preferred that the money go to themselves. Seeking to reclaim their inheritance, the heirs brought a suit against the society, arguing that Miss Hopkins' provision should be set aside on the grounds that the search would be a wild goose chase. To support their case, they solicited the testimony of scholarly experts. The Right Honorable Richard Wilberforce, a justice of Her Majesty's High Court, presided. Counsel for the next of kin described it as a wild goose chase, but wild geese can, with good fortune, be apprehended, observed the justice. Many discoveries are unlikely until they are made, he pointed out. One may think of the Codex Sinaiticus, or the Tomb of Tutankhamun, or the Dead Sea Scrolls. Wilberforce was a stolid Englishman, a former classics scholar at Oxford University, who rose through Britain's legal ranks to become a senior law lord in the House of Lords and a member of the Queen's Privy Council. Having reviewed the evidence submitted to the court, he summarized it as follows. The orthodox opinion, which at the present time is unanimous, or nearly so, among scholars and experts in 16th and 17th century literature and history, is that the plays were written by William Shakespeare of Stratford-upon-Avon, actor. However, Justice Wilberforce continued, the evidence in favor of Shakespeare's authorship is quantitatively slight. It rests positively, in the main, on the explicit statements in the first folio of 1623 and on continuous tradition. Negatively, on the lack of any challenge to this ascription at the time of the first folio's publication. Furthermore, the justice found, there are a number of difficulties in the way of the traditional ascription, a number of known facts which are difficult to reconcile. So far from these difficulties tending to diminish with time, the intensive search of the 19th century has widened the evidentiary gulf between William Shakespeare the man and the author of the plays. The justice went on to consider the testimony of the scholarly experts. Kenneth Muir, King Alfred Professor of English Literature at the University of Liverpool, supported the plaintiffs, Miss Hopkins' aggrieved heirs. He considered it certain that Bacon could not have written the works of Shakespeare. Hugh Trevor Roper, Regius Professor of Modern History at the University of Oxford, departed slightly from his English literature colleagues, taking what the justice deemed a more cautious line. Though Professor Trevor Roper definitely does not believe that the works of Shakespeare could have been written by Francis Bacon, he also considers that the case for Shakespeare rests on a narrow balance of evidence, and that new material could upset it. That though almost all professional scholars accept Shakespeare's authorship, a settled scholarly tradition can inhibit free thought, that heretics are not necessarily wrong. His conclusion is that the question of authorship cannot be considered as closed. Justice Wilberforce agreed. The question was not closed. The evidence for Shakespeare was too slim, the problems too many. The scholars might be wrong. Even if Francis Bacon was unlikely, new material might show someone other than Shakespeare to have been the author. Whoever wrote them, the manuscripts of Shakespeare's plays had never been found. Their discovery would be of the highest value to history and to literature, Wilberforce proclaimed. Indeed, he added, to the consternation of the plaintiffs and the Shakespeare scholars, the revelation of a manuscript would contribute, probably decisively, to a solution to the authorship problem, and this alone is benefit enough. Miss Hopkins' bequest to the Francis Bacon Society was upheld. 1. The question that does not exist. Who has the authority to determine the truth about the past? Usually the answer is historians. In the case of Shakespeare, it is Shakespeare scholars, a small but highly prestigious subset of English literature professors concentrated mostly in Britain and America. Their prestige derives from their specialty. They are priests, not of one of the lesser gods of the English literary pantheon, but of the highest god, the god who gives English literature as a discipline its very raison d'être. They act as his representatives, interpreting and mediating for the masses the meaning of Shakespeare. And so, like the priests of the sun god Apollo, they glow with the radiance cast by his rays. Among Shakespeare scholars, the Shakespeare authorship question, the theory that William Shakespeare might not have written the works published under his name, does not exist. That is, it is not permitted. As a consequence, it has become the most horrible, vexed, unspeakable subject in the history of English literature. In literary circles, even the phrase Shakespeare authorship question elicits contempt, eye-rolling, name-calling, mudslinging. If you raise it casually in a social setting, someone might chastise you as though you've uttered a deeply offensive profanity. Someone else might get up and leave the room. Tears may be shed, a whip may be produced. You will be punished, which is to say, educated. Because it is obscene to suggest that the god of English literature might be a false god. It is heresy. The heresy persists because the difficulties in the way of the traditional ascription, as Justice Wilberforce termed them, have not been resolved. The longer scholars have tried to resolve them, the more they've learned about the man from Stratford-upon-Avon and about the plays and poems, the wider the evidentiary gulf has grown between the man and the works. For instance, William of Stratford had no recorded education. At most, he may have attended his local grammar school, which taught Latin grammar and arithmetic. But the works published under the name William Shakespeare are dazzling in their erudition, steeped in the learning of Renaissance humanism. He was at home in the Aristotelian cosmology of his time. He had learned the new Platonic philosophy, marveled Hugh Trevor Roper, the Oxford historian who testified in the 1964 lawsuit. He was familiar with foreign countries, foreign affairs, foreign languages. Another difficulty, scholars have turned up a mass of personal records from the man's lifetime, more, it is often said, than exist for other writers of the period. They show his theatrical activities, his financial and property transactions, his lawsuits. They show that he was a businessman, an actor, a shareholder in an acting company, and a property investor. But they don't show that he wrote. As the Oxford historian Blair Warden laments, the extent and loudness of the documentary silence are startling. This silence aggravates scholars in the extreme. I would love to find a contemporary document that said William Shakespeare was the dramatist of Stratford-upon-Avon written during his lifetime, Sir Stanley Wells told Newsweek. That would shut the buggers up. Why don't the plays and poems bear any connection to the man's life? The relationship between an artist's biography and his writing is always a difficult subject, concedes Warden. But there can be no other important writer, since the invention of printing, for whom we are unable to demonstrate any relationship at all. Why didn't Shakespeare bother to educate his children? His daughters couldn't write. One signed with what Sir Edward Maunde Thompson, paleographer and director of the British Museum, called a painfully formed signature, which was probably the most that she was capable of doing with the pen. The other, he concluded, could not write at all, for she signed with a mark. How could a writer, any writer, let alone the greatest writer in the English language, be indifferent to the literacy of his children? Why didn't he mention his writing in his will? When he died, he left detailed instructions for the distribution of his assets, but mentioned no books, poems, or manuscripts of any kind. At his death, only half of his plays had been published. Did he have no concern for their preservation? Why didn't he say anything about his poems? Several major.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.